Did you know that Sky has an awesome loyalty program called Sky VIP? You get to access places no one else can.
We've just seen Craig David.
It's been amazing.
Thank you, Sky VIP.
Fan of movies? You can meet the A-listers.
Hello, Matthew.
Mr. John Cena.
Very nice to meet you both.
And if you like sports, you can be mixing it with your heroes.
Pleasure to meet you.
I don't get much better than that.
This year, over a million people can enjoy a Sky VIP experience on us. Sky VIP, your loyalty program.
I ain't got nothing but sorrow. Would your conscience ever bother you? How can you watch me cry after all I've done for you? I gave my heart and soul to you, didn't I? If you needed me, was always there, wasn't I? Baby, don't you leave me standing in the shadows of love. Come on, just waiting for the morning.
do to deserve your queen? What did he ever say to make you wanna leave? I gave my heart and soul to you, didn't I? Everybody together, you needed me, was always there, wasn't I? Baby, don't you leave me, stand in the shadows of love, waiting for the heartaches to come. Love, standing in the shadows of love.
Another day, another night, I long to hold you tight, because I'm so lonely.
Baby, I need your loving,
yeah.
Got to have all your loving,
baby.
Baby, I need
your love,
got to have all your loving.
Those empty nights echo your name. Sometimes I wonder, will I ever be the same? Oh yeah, when you see me smile, you know things have gotten worse. Any smile you might see is all been rehearsed. Darling, I can't go on without you. This emptiness inside won't let me live without you. This loneliness inside me, darling, makes me feel half alive.
Baby, I need your loving. Got to have all.
The other day I was kind of messing around in the kitchen, because that's all I do in the kitchen is mess around. And I heard the announcer on the TV say, "Get your oldies but goodies." And I heard this familiar sound. It suddenly occurred to me that I am an oldie. That's what I... Baby.
coming back. Now my arms are missing you. My lips feel the same way too. I try so hard to be true, like I promised I'd do. But this boy keeps coming around. He's trying to wear my resistance.
Living in So there you have it. Just some of the huge names who helped bring to life the magical songs Lamont Dozier conjured up over his extraordinary career. But what about the great man himself? Well, we're ending tonight with a rare performance from Lamont on Later with Jules. The song is a classic, a hit from Marvin Gaye and James Taylor. How sweet it is to be loved by you. And how sweet it is to share this with you. From 2004, this is Motown master Lamont Dozier at the BBC.
If you remember the words of this, just sing along with it. It ain't gonna cost you a dime. All right? I needed the shelter of someone's arms, and there you were. I needed someone to understand my ups and downs, and there you were. With sweet love and devotion, deeply touching my emotions, I wanna stop and thank you, baby. I just wanna stop and thank you, darling. Yeah. How sweet it is to be loved by you. Y'all over there too, come on with it. You in my life. Everything I did was such a bore. Every place I went seems I've been there before. But you brightened up all my days. I said, with a love.
Song after song in fine voice here on BBC Two paved the way for when Motown came to Britain next.
We light the fire.
Welcome to Versailles.
We're looking for 6 robbers and 3 tons of gold.
There is a lot going on right now, but this is very exciting!
Let's look to the future.
You do know this could be dangerous, don't you?
I am not confessing to something that I didn't do.
I deserve to be something.
It's blowing up.
I am just in awe of what I am seeing.
Well, then we best get started.
New for 2023 on BBC iPlayer.
Welcome back to the FA Cup.
It's a result that explains why this is the most unique competition.
Oh, what a goal that is!
Chance to win it!
Gillingham v Leicester.
What a shot from Youri Tielemans.
Sheffield Wednesday v Newcastle United.
To seal the deal!
And Manchester City v Chelsea in the FA Cup third round.
As has been said, anything could happen.
Start Saturday at 12:15 on BBC One and iPlayer.
Marvin Gaye live at Montreux in an hour. Now on BBC Two, this programme may be brand new, but the songs are etched deep into our souls. Take it away on New Year's Day.
It's my pleasure to introduce 3 girls who made a tremendous impact in America and are going to show up in the charts here too. It's welcome to Martha and the Vandellas.
People always reference Motown as being, you know, the pinnacle of achievement.
These young people change music forever.
So I was like, I wonder who these American groups are. I've never heard of them. The kind of funny names,
and miracles and marvelettes.
Dave was fairly well single-handedly responsible for bringing Motown to the British public.
He helped in every way that you can possibly imagine to further our career.
It was bringing heaven to your hometown. It was extraordinary.
And I got on stage, and there was Stevie Wonder waiting.
After show, went backstage and met everybody. What a day.
Well, this middle bit was totally empty.
Yeah. Well, they called it the ghost tour.
Motown was more than just great music. It was a total game changer in terms of the perception of what black people are.
That was the power of Motown. That was the power of the music that was coming from Motown.
So much energy, so much presentation. I mean, we're just going, oh my God, this is the future.
Look around. This is your new gym. Get instant access to more than 600 classes and over 20 training plans, led by the most in-demand trainers, all designed to take you to the next level. Track your progress, amp it up, and get results. This is Fit.
When he was six, he realized he was totally different to everybody. He joined any club he could get his hands on.
You know, there was a female.
It's about soul, the voice. There's something there. We'll be right back.
Dashing through the snow in a one horse.
Hate that I remember. I wish I could forget what you did last December.
Literally hear the drum kit moving around, and they left it in. They left all that stuff. But those things is what made it sound so different. It was that rawness.
Marty Wilde or any of the big pop stars of the day.
I don't think music was exciting before Motown for me. I really didn't like Frank Ifield and Cliff Richard. Sorry.
Then the world is yours.
Drab. It really was drab.
Thank you.
So what happened was, originally, the BBC had kind of ignored pop music, and along came offshore radio, and they were playing, you know, pop 24 hours a day, basically. Radio Luxembourg. It was a medium wave station broadcasting from Luxembourg, and so the reception was very, very patchy. And Radio Caroline was our pirate radio station, anchored off in the North Sea.
Somehow I was listening to the radio, and in amongst all this strange stuff, you heard Pride and Joy by Marvin Gaye. Or Mickey's Monkey by The Miracles. And it was just fantastic.
Those days, nearly every artist had a fan club, but they'd be amateur fan clubs. It wouldn't be anything to do with the record label in particular.
Dave Godin wrote to Berry Gordy and said, can I start a fan club? Shock, surprise, letter came back, yes, you can. Wow. It became the Tamla Motown Appreciation Society.
Berry Gordy had a whole family of little soul labels. Tamla, Motown, Gordy, Soul, VIP. Dave was the first person to use that expression, Tamla Motown.
Everything was done in this, like, 12-by-12 bedroom in a house in Bexley Heath.
Dave typed every single issue himself, did the layouts. The lettering was done with a product called Letraset.
Cut and paste, little diagrams here and there. The days where you had to cover your mistakes with a bit of Tippex.
It's the life of the artisan. You own the means of production. And Dave was hot for that.
See, I do actually see art as having a didactic purpose. I do feel that art, in a sense, should be a vehicle for conveying ideas.
And you look at these magazines now that he produced, they're iconic. He didn't get paid, he just studied for the love of it.
5 shillings, I think it was. So I sent off my postal order to Church Road, Bexley Heath, Kent. And a few days later, got a little sort of handmade card. You better take another look there. You got a badge which said Swinger and Friend with two printer's fists on it.
High contrast. If set to on, your Sky Q box will display in high contrast. 5 of 6. Voice guidance. Supported content on screen will be described audibly. Select, with hints, to hear extra details, recommended for new users. Warning, turning this on will turn off Dolby Digital 5.1 audio. 6 of 6. Press right to manage setting. On with hints. On without hints. Press up or down for options. 2 of off. Press up or down for options.
3.
Off. High contrast. If set to on, your Sky Q box will display in high contrast. 5 of 6. Select to turn on.
Important one. And we always used to watch it because
off.
Any pop fan would.
He was 13 years old, and Dusty Ringfield, myself, had gone to the Olympia in Paris, basically to see the Shirelles. But we didn't know that the package included Dionne Warwick, who was absolutely fabulous, and little Stevie Wonder. And we went back afterwards and talked to Stevie's people and said, what are you doing after the Olympia? And they said, going home. And we said, no, you're coming to London first to be on Ready Steady. And they said yes. So that was the first Motown artist on Ready Steady Girl. So much energy. Included the audience. They loved him, and so did we. I mean, we're just going. The future.
My pleasure to introduce 3 girls. In the sharp in the charts here too. It's welcome to Martha and the Vandellas.
A ready, steady, go was absolutely essential. If you were in the pop music business in the early 1960s, you needed to be on that TV show in Britain. It was the Beatles did it, Stones did it.
Unusual.
We were fortunate enough to get a recording before a record.
There was a sense of pride, if you like, because as a black person, there weren't many people of your kind of background and colour to even look at. You know, so when you saw people and they were really good, that was a real bonus.
So we sat down together, the three of us, including our Barry Gordy, our boss, and we put little words together and made Vandellas.
Friday night ritual was watching Ready, Steady, Go, not just because of the British artists that were on there, but of course of the American artists, because we got to see people that even in America didn't necessarily get to be on like a major Friday night TV show. It was amazing.
We'd have meetings and we would listen to the records and people would say, I love that. Sometimes I'd have to argue and say, I'm going to book it whether you like it or not. But not very often. Usually everybody was, you know, agreed on what we could and should do.
Motown really didn't mean anything in Britain until, you could argue, 1964. I mean, the first hit that Motown had in Britain was Mary Wells' My Guy. Top five in the British chart. And Motown was fortunate in following it up fairly swiftly after My Guy with The Supremes. When you have hits, people want to know more about you. And then, so what is Motown, and who is Berry Gordy, and where do they come from?
The Supremes definitely paved the way for every girl band that's ever existed ever since. You couldn't have had Destiny's Child if you never had the Supremes, right? Baby Love, or, you know, anything that the Supremes did, you just wanted to be them. They looked great.
I remember clearly seeing the Supremes on Top of the Pop. You know, to see black people on the television doing their music and singing so beautiful songs, and songs that reminisce with you as a black person. Oh God.
Bands of the 60s, there were so few black musicians. I remember Georgie Fame and the Blue Flames had a black percussion player, and that stood out to me. People used to say, is that your uncle?
And they showed him all around the buildings, then Marvin Gaye turned up.
You know, intimate details that you wouldn't do with just anybody.
I think Berry Gordy brought him over because Berry Gordy was a smart businessman, and he saw an amazing opportunity for this whole stable of artists that he was building. And the idea of having someone in Britain who would be an advocate for that obviously appealed to him.
Berry Gordy came to rely on him, came to trust his opinions. He had Berry Gordy's ear.
The fact is, they put Dave on the payroll, and he got paid to do the Tamla Motown Appreciation Society, and he got paid to do the magazine, Hitsville USA. So that was obviously a business move.
Dave actually said, you've got too many labels. You need an identity for what you're selling in Britain. And he literally wrote all Berry Gordy's label names down on slips of paper, chopped them up, moved them around on a table until two words came together that said Tamla Motown. And Gordy loved it. He says, yeah, that's great.
And a lot of people don't realise that actually that was a British thing. There is no Tamla Motown in America.
So it is quite safe to say that if Dave Godin had never existed, we would not have the label Tamla Motown.
This came in an envelope one morning and I thought, what's this? Why am I getting a record? It was a treasure to behold.
Since we have
now, this is the Hitsville USA, the greetings to Tamla Motown Appreciation Society members. The record that was sent to TMAS members by Dave Godin on behalf of the Motown Recording Corporation.
Greetings to all of you swingers and friends. This is Berry Gordy.
That those artists were coming to the UK, I was going to be able to see them in concert. You know, it was bringing heaven to your hometown. It was extraordinary. The artists in the second week of March began to fly into London. Martha and the Vandellas and Stevie and the Miracles and the Supremes, Earl Van Dyke and the Band, and the Temptations, who came in only for promotion. They didn't join the tour.
We were in awe, a state of awe, because it was a shock to us to see that we are being received so wonderfully well by the English people. That was the power of Motown. That was the power of the music that was coming from Motown.
I was a newspaper man at the Detroit Free Press, and one day one of the Motown guys said, hey, we're all going to London. Why don't you come along and write stories about it? I thought this was really exciting. And so I ended up going with them. Even as a 30-year-old journalist, I'd spent time with consequential people. What made this group so unique was its accessibility. You could sit and have a conversation with anybody, and they were young and open and in so many ways innocent, and would answer almost any question you'd ask.
We were beyond excitement because, you know, you're talking about actually another world, something outside of the United States, you know, another country.
They'd come off that plane, and all of a sudden there was all these kids with these little bunches of flowers and chocolates and banners saying, "We welcome you." You wouldn't get that these days, would you? Nobody would do that. It must have been a very magical moment for Dave Godin.
Springfield.
The Ready Steady Go special was done basically by Dusty Springfield. She loved the music.
Elkin Allen was my boss, and I sat down and said, "You won't believe this, but they're absolutely great. The music is incredible." And he said, "Let me stop you. Will Dusty present it?" I said, "Oh, yes." I thought, she better, because we haven't even discussed it.
Here with his great new record, Kiss Me Baby, it's Stevie Wonder!
I mean, everybody was having a good time.
Dusty was a wonderful spirit, you know. She was a great door opener for Motown.
What a joy to hear that. Excited. We knew that we were doing something that was kind of a miracle, because who on earth would let us have this many American black artists on one show? We invited the Motown Appreciation. Dave Godin was so important and so much part of the birth of Motown. And little David Nathan, who was probably 15 or 16 at that stage.
Yeah.
Forrest Gump. Watch Sky Atlantic.
Better.
You can find shows, open apps, and move through Sky Q using your voice. All you need is a paired Sky Q remote with a voice button on the side or front. Your Sky Q box also needs to be connected to the internet. To use voice control, press and hold the voice button and speak clearly into the microphone below the Sky button, then let go. Billions. You can move through shows, fast forward, open apps, Netflix. Move around Sky Q. Go to TV Guide. Go to Sky Atlantic. Change accessibility settings, turn on subtitles, and more. For more, go to sky.com/help.
That music that meant so much to me. I mean, it was like that moment I could have died and gone to heaven.
Because the sales were really not good, they added Georgie Fame.
Early 65, we just had our first number one hit. So we were kind of flavor of the month at that particular time. We were tickled pink, I think is the phrase, just to think that we were of the same importance musically to be part of that tour. We were in two coaches, and the musicians were on one coach and the artists on another. Well, touring was awful because there were no motorways to start with, so you were travelling on country roads. Each theatre had a catchment area, which was 50 miles around it. So you couldn't do two consecutive dates within 50 miles of one another. So you had to go north, south, up, down, all over the place.
It was pretty much a really grueling tour. Some of the places were quite a distance. And having the schedule, you know, you wanted to make sure that you did your very best and not only just doing your best, but while you were there, you know, so you present yourself well to your audience. You didn't want to appear like you were so tired until you could barely make it off the bus.
The tour bus was like a home, but everybody got along. Everybody knew that this was part of the job. Now, there were little spats And
it was singing. There was like a lot of joking, telling stories, you know, all of the above that you could think of to keep you entertained, and not only just entertained, but probably many times awake.
Well, I took my camera everywhere. I was trying to film it.
Hello, everyone. I'm Angelica Bell, and over the next few minutes, I'm going to help you get the very best out of your Sky Q, your television and sound system. Now, whatever you've got and however you've got it wired, we are going to take you through everything you need to know to get the very most out of it. Now, I've come in today, and it's a beautiful day outside. The birds are singing, and there's not a cloud in the sky. So here I am in a windowless TV studio with no aircon in southwest London. Still, I can't complain. I like what they've done with the place. It's pretty cool, yeah. But let's be honest, it's not as nice as the one they gave to Idris Elba in those Sky adverts. Just saying. But the main thing is, there is a cool sofa. So limber up, get warm and ready, guys, because we are about to do some serious, and I mean serious, sitting down. Everything that you need to do to tweak your Sky Q setup can be done from the comfort of your sofa. And to make this as easy as possible, we've broken everything down into different sections, starting from the basics and working our way through to how you can optimize the brightness, contrast, and color settings for your own living room. We also want to make sure you've got the sharpest and best pictures possible. And finally, if you have a separate sound system, how to configure your audio setup. You got that? Good. But before we get on with the more advanced stuff, there are a few things that would help with this tutorial and make it go smoothly. Firstly, it's a good idea to get to know your TV's remote control. And also, why not grab the instruction manuals for your TV, Sky Q box, and home cinema system to help you with this tutorial. Remember, your TV will always have a default or factory setting in case you want to restore them at any point. Just make sure you remember how to select that before you begin. That way, you've only got yourself to blame and not me or Sky. Just saying. Now, as you can imagine, there are many different models of high definition and ultra high definition TVs out there. And each manufacturer has their own unique way of changing the basic settings. That's why it's really important to have your manuals to hand, because different manufacturers use different terms and names for their features. And some settings may not even apply to your TV. So, for this purpose and for this tutorial, I'll be using the most well-known or generic terms. And do not worry if you get stuck. You can always rewind this tutorial and go through each section again until you're happy that you've got everything set up as you want. And just so you know, we've numbered the sections to make it easy for you, so you can skip over the ones that don't apply to your setup and return to the menu at any time to navigate to the next relevant section. If, however, you are already a technical Jedi and are happy to calibrate your own system, then why not skip to the end and check out our two brand new test cards that will help you configure your system and get the best out of your television. But for everyone else, here's a quick preview, and please do not worry if this means nothing to your system and get the best out of your television. But for everyone else, here's a quick preview, and please do not worry if this means nothing to you yet, because it will, I promise. And as we go through each part of the setup, we'll explain how both cards work and how you can use them to calibrate your own system to give you the very best performance. Talking of performance, let's get on with the show and see what's on.
Cleaning, suits for cleaning. And whoever was looking after Stevie at the time gave them Stevie's suit to get cleaned. And of course, it never came back.
Right, folks, in this section, we're going to look at your HD or UHD setup. Now, when you first had SkyQ installed, it will have been set up to your screen's resolution. So if you had HD, then Sky's recommended HD resolution would be 1080i. And that just means, and I've just learnt this myself, I'm being completely honest, the number of lines per image that Sky currently broadcasts HD in. So if you want to check if you're currently watching in HD or UHD, then go to the settings menu, select setup, and scroll down to the audio visual option. This is where it will show your current resolution and settings. And please remember that for the moment, UHD is only available through your main SkyQ box and not through a Sky mini box. And if you already had a UHD TV before your SkyQ was connected, then they should have already configured the screen to be connected correctly. So someone did it for you. So much easier. But some of you will already know there's a new girl in town with twice the amount of lines and four times the number of pixels per image than HD, giving an overall more detailed picture. Welcome to the world of UHD. I know. Yes, UHD has around four times the amount of resolution as HD. And if you've got a TV that supports UHD, then you can configure your television to enjoy all the movies, sports, and shows that you love in a bigger and better definition than ever before. Now, before we go any further, let's try and keep things simple. You've probably also heard of the term 4K as well as UHD. Well, if we're being 100% accurate, 4K is almost identical to UHD in format, but marginally wider to accommodate those huge cinema screen dimensions. But for the purposes of this tutorial, we'll be sticking to one term throughout, and that'll be UHD. Like I said, we're going to keep this simple. Do you know what I think? I think we've got enough acronyms flying around already. OMG, LOL. Oh, and FYI, to make sure that you're seeing true UHD footage, then you need to Acronyms flying around already. OMG, LOL. Oh, and FYI, to make sure that you're seeing true UHD footage, then you need to configure your TV in a similar way to configuring HD. If this is your first trip into UHD territory, then do not worry. Let's get ready to venture out of our comfort zones and into the new frontier together.
You could have just put them on Motown and nobody would have known the difference.
Through Motown and, you know, being...
To configure your UHD setup, what you'll need to do, now pay attention here because there are a lot of menus in this, and I'm not talking about the food variety, is go into your set-top box menu, select settings, and then setup. There you will see another menu for audio-visual. Under that, you will see an option for picture resolution, which will automatically be set at 1080i, the default setting for regular HD TV. This is where you can select 2160p to configure your TV to a UHD resolution if you have a TV that supports the UHD format, and that's really important. So here are your three options. Find it for me. I mean, that's the lazy one. 10-bit or 8-bit. For UHD, 10-bit is the one you want, as it gives each pixel more levels of detail and colour. However, some TVs need a little more encouragement, and you might have to manually select the TV's input to UHD or deep colour mode. The deep colour settings can usually be found under the HDMI section in the TV's menu. And if Find It For Me doesn't work, try selecting the manual 10-bit option for a UHD output. And similar to before, the 8-bit setting is the default for an older standard HD setup. Once you select it, Find It For Me or 10-bit, the screen should go blank for a few seconds. And if you've been successful, then you will see a message asking you if you want these settings. Select yes, but within 10 seconds, the box will revert back to the default settings. You've got to be quick, I'm telling you. Once you've confirmed, you should then see the magical words, "You are now set up to get Ultra HD, hurrah!" Now, you might remember in the introduction that I mentioned some test cards which would help you configure your setup correctly. Well, here's where the cards really come into play. To double-check the resolution your TV is currently displaying, you can use this section at the bottom. The vertical lines vary in width as we move across the screen from left to right. The final lines are at the far right, and these should be visible in UHD. If this region appears as a grey box instead, you are watching in HD only. You can access our test cards from the top menu to help configure the best settings for your TV. They're the last two sections in this group of tutorials. One is for HDR and the other SDR. You can access our test cards from the top menu to help configure the best settings for your TV. They're the last two sections in this group of tutorials. One is for HDR and the other SDR. But if you're wondering what HDR and SDR means, I'm glad you asked. What does it mean? Only joking. Now we're rolling. Let's crack on and move on to the next chapter, how to configure your dynamic ranges.
Absolutely. It was very exciting. I had heard a couple of the
Well, we've got at least one whole minute without throwing some acronyms at you. So brace yourself for two more. SDR and HDR. But what are they? And what difference do they make to your picture? Well, just in case you've never heard of these terms before, SDR and HDR stand for standard dynamic range and high dynamic range. But what is a dynamic range? Well, simply put, it's the number of colours and levels of brightness your TV setup can display, from the whitest white to the blackest black and every colour in between. And here's where it gets a little complicated. If you have an HD setup, then you automatically have a standard dynamic range, which looks great, it's easy on the eye, and does the job of showing a wide range of colours and shading. But if you have a UHD setup, you can either have the same standard dynamic range as HD does, or if your TV allows you to, you'll be able to watch available programs in a high dynamic range. The difference is that HDR has even more colors in its palette, has a better contrast ratio, and will give you so much more detail in the brightest and darkest parts of your picture. So basically, HDR allows you to enjoy a more vivid experience. Okay, well, here's an example. In SDR, sometimes there aren't enough shades of a colour to blend seamlessly across certain images, and you'll be able to spot something called banding, where you can see lines appearing across an image. Even though SDR can deliver over 16 million colours, your HDR display could give you over a billion different colours, meaning the images just blend together even more seamlessly, giving you an even more beautifully detailed and vivid picture. To test if your TV can display HDR images or if it's SDR only, then you can use the test cards we mentioned in the previous chapter to put your setup through the necessary paces. To check your SDR and HDR, you'll mainly be looking at this part of the card. These bars will look smooth with no banding on if you're watching in HDR. However, if you can see any banding, then your setup is displaying SDR, which should mean one of two things. Either your setup can only display SDR, or you may still be in 8-bit mode. Quickly check your UHD settings on the SkyQ menu, like we spoke about before, to make sure you have 10-bit selected, and fingers crossed, you could be HDR capable after all. Now, as we briefly mentioned before, we've included two test cards at the end of this tutorial. So which one should you be using when you're configuring your setup? Well, if you've established that your TV can only display SDR, then the SDR test card is the one and only card you'll need. But for HDR users, it's important to remember that not everything Sky broadcasts can be shown in HDR. For example, some older material might only broadcast in SDR. Therefore, if you are HDR capable, you should use the HDR test card to help tweak your settings. But in addition to that, you may need to do another calibration using the SDR card. Now, that's because when your TV switches between the two formats, depending on what you're watching, it may not apply all the settings you saved from your HDR calibrations to your SDR output, or vice versa. You still with me? All right, just take a moment. Take a breath. Should we do a basic recap? There's a lot of information there. Okay. SDR viewers only ever need the SDR test card, whereas for HDR viewers, it's a good idea to use both cards and do calibrations for each. We've got this, team. We can do this. Just a reminder that the test cards can be found via the main tutorial menu in the last two. Good idea to use both cards and do calibrations for each. We've got this, team. We can do this. Just a reminder that the test cards can be found via the main tutorial menu in the last two chapters. But before you take a look at those, there are a few more sections that you might want to tweak to get the best out of your setup. So let's keep this momentum going. We can do this and move on to the next chapter.
Commercial by some of the regional franchise TV stations around the UK.
Next up is aspect ratio and positioning of picture. HD and UHD only ever broadcast in an aspect ratio of 16:9 widescreen. And rather conveniently, as you're using an HDMI cable to connect your Sky Q box to your TV, it will automatically be set to 16:9. And it's worth remembering that if you've made the step up to UHD, your old HDMI cable may not be up to the needs of the latest UHD content. So it's a really good idea to get a good quality one so you get the most out of your setup. However, some TVs can lose a bit of the overall picture at the edges, so it's best to make sure the entire image is displayed and at the right ratio. On our test cards, you'll be able to see some arrows to the top, bottom, left and right of the picture. Make sure that the white point of each arrow just touches the edge of your screen. If the grey point of the arrow is touching the edge, then you're losing some of your overall image. So to fix this, you need to adjust your TV's picture settings. Your TV may have a zoom or just scan function with a specific 16:9 aspect ratio setting to do this. So adjust your screen until you see the most amount of picture, and also make sure the circle in the center of the test card is a true circle, not an egg or a rug. But a perfect round circle. Perfect. So now that we're looking at the bigger picture and in the correct ratio, let's make it look as beautiful as possible by checking out the brightness and contrast levels.
Do something like Motown.
Here's a question for you. How do you watch your movies and TV shows? With a few lights on and the curtains ajar? I know, it's a bit personal. Or in a room like a darkened cinema? Because your black levels or brightness and contrast depend on how you watch television. A darkened room is better as you'll get more from your TV and less reflections of bright objects. Plus, you'll see more details in the dark areas if you're in a darker room, and those shadows will teem with life. Setting your brightness and contrast will depend on whether you are viewing in HDR or SDR, as the high dynamic range output has higher white levels and lower black levels, giving you a wider range between the lightest and darkest parts of the scene. Like we mentioned before, if you are able to watch in HDR, you may also need to tweak these brightness and contrast settings using both versions of the test card, as some TVs remember HDR and SDR settings independently. So to help you adjust this level, you can use this area of the test cards. This is our grey scale, a collection of shaded squares which help you to calibrate your brightness and contrast. If your TV remote will allow, alter the brightness until you can only just see the black sky logo within the darkest square. And if the logo disappears, then your brightness setting is too low and you should increase it slightly until the sky logo only just reappears. Once you're happy with that, it's time to adjust your contrast settings. In the lightest square, you should just about be able to make out the grey sky logo inside. If the logo disappears, then your contrast level is too high and you'll need to reduce it slightly until the logo just reappears. The final adjustment is up to you. Not too dark. Disappears, then your contrast level is too high and you'll need to reduce it slightly until the logo just reappears. The final adjustment is up to you. Not too dull, not too bright, and as a general rule of thumb, it shouldn't hurt your eyes when you look at the screen. Once you're happy with everything, then you're ready to move on to the next section. How to balance the correct colour levels.
How hot's the planet gonna get?
Anne will explain why prices keep going up and up.
Also, Rach, did you know space has its own smell?
Really? What of? The world is fast-moving and can be confusing.
So let's talk about it.
Five Live Breakfast with Rach.
Getting your screen to look absolutely perfect is addictive, so I'm glad you're still with us. Now, in this section, we're going to help you make sure that you have the correct colour levels for your setup. Once again, lots of TVs have different ways of setting the colour temperature and saturation. So check your manufacturer's manual, and then you can adjust accordingly. And here's something to help you get your levels set just as you like them. If your TV remote will allow it, adjust the colour settings to make these beautiful looking faces look most natural to your eye. Each face should not be too glowing and red or sickly and green, but they should look absolutely natural to you. Use these colour bars to adjust the colour saturation. The primary colours, red, blue and green, should look vibrant and have a natural hue, as well as the secondary colours, yellow, cyan and magenta. Also check the grey areas within the card. All the shades should be true greys and not have any hint of colour to them. If you can see a colour tint across the greys, adjust your TV's colour temperature setting until it looks natural. Some TV manufacturers may use different terms for this setting, so refer back to your TV manual if in doubt. All good? Great. So now you've got your faces and your colour scales all looking perfect. You're ready to move on to the next chapter. Boom. Exciting! So we only have one last visual element of the setup process left, making sure your images are sharp and clearly defined. Now, hopefully your TV should have the sharpness settings already calibrated and looking great. And if so, then there's no need to adjust anything. This is one element of the setup process where we would definitely say, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. So to help you check your TV's sharpness, then you can use the black and white squares on these parts of the test cards. You will see they have black lines passing through the white squares and white lines passing through the black squares. All the lines should be clearly defined all the way through, and the edges should be smooth and clean, not blurry edges or ghostly double edges. It should also be clean black and white with no colour bleeding across the joins. You can then quickly check the resolution chart at the bottom to make sure you can see all the lines clearly. Like we said, hopefully this should already be set up correctly. But if not, then you may need to use your TV's remote and adjust your picture sharpness to get the best possible look. And remember, if you're only viewing in HD, then you'll only see the fine lines resolved up to HD resolution. The UHD resolution on the far right will appear fuzzy and blurred. To get a true full UHD resolution, you'll need a UHD TV and UHD SkyQ set-top box. So, that's the visuals covered, but we're not quite there yet. One more chapter to go, only this time we're moving on to the audio elements. So if you don't have a separate sound system, you can skip straight to the test cards and configure all the elements we've covered so far. But for those of you with a sound system, select the next chapter, turn it up to 11 and prepare yourself. It's gonna get loud. Now we know our UHDs from our HDs and our SDRs from our HDRs, it's time to leave the picture alone. Stop. Next up, we are going to configure your sound options. And whoever said a picture is worth 1,000 words clearly didn't have immersive audio. Now, if you don't have a 5.1 or immersive home cinema system, then you can skip this section. Go on, just move straight on to the test cards. But for those of us still here, let's double check the basics before we go through your speaker configuration and talk about Dolby 5.1 and Dolby Atmos. Both of these make watching TV a truly cinematic experience. So with over 5 channels of audio and a rumbling bass, you'll be blown away by the action. And with Atmos, you can add height to your experience for true immersion. But before we get to that, make sure your speakers are wired up correctly, not just in the right position, but also with like-for-like wires going into the speakers, because if you get this wrong, you'll hear strange phasing sounds, and some speakers may even cancel each other out. And nobody wants to watch TV in mono, do they now? Now, for a Dolby 5.1 configuration, the speakers are located around the room in their respective positions. Front left, front right, the center speaker, the rear left speaker, and the rear right speaker. And the final speaker in the 5.1 setup is for low frequency sound and is usually called the subwoofer or the LFE, which stands for low frequency effects. But honestly, I much prefer the term subwoofer. It sounds way more fun and I love saying it. Woofer, woofer. Back in the room. So, to start with, you should be hearing this from your front left speaker. If not, then your speakers aren't set up correctly and you do need to reset them. This should only be coming from the front left. Rewind this section if you need more time. Next, you should only be able to hear this coming from your front right speaker. If not, then once again, you've guessed it, your speakers are incorrectly set up and you do need to reset them. Next up, the center speaker. So you should only be able to hear this coming from your center speaker. If not, then you'll need to reset your speakers once more. Next, let's check your back left speaker. You should only be hearing this from your back left. If not, then you'll need to reset your speakers once more. Next up, back right. Once again, you should only be hearing this from your back right speaker. If not, then go and check your speaker setup. Finally, your subwoofer. Ooh, woofer. So if all those sounds are coming from the correct speakers, then your 5.1 system is all wired up correctly and ready to go. Your home cinema system should now be set up correctly and receiving Dolby Digital 5.1 surround sound. But for those of you who have UHD and an external amplifier that's compatible, you can now watch your favorite shows in Dolby Atmos. We're going to get a little more complex now because Dolby Atmos really takes it to the next level. Depending on the size of your room and how much of an audiophile you are, Atmos allows you to add two or more extra speakers on both sides, either at height or upfiring from the floor so that you can have an even more immersive experience when you're watching your favorite films and TV shows. So if you have Atmos speakers, let's run a quick test through these as well. Hopefully you heard the audio coming from the correct places, and if so, then your Atmos speakers are configured correctly. If not, you know what to do. Check the wiring and ensure they're connected correctly. And just when you thought the test cards couldn't be any more useful, we've added some test blips so you can check your Dolby setup at any time, as well as ensuring that your sound system is in sync. Take a look at the dials here on the test cards. As the pointer in the dial hits the top, you will hear a blip. But if your sound system is out of sync, then the blip will be heard either before or after the pointer reaches the top. If it appears that you have a sync issue, then do not worry. You can calibrate your system via the SkyQ box by adding a delay. This can be found under the audio visual menu, where you can add your delay to your HDMI or optical audio output, whichever one your sound system is using. Then you can adjust the sound delay to synchronize what you see on your TV to what you hear. Following on from the blips and dials, you'll see that we've added a test for each speaker in a Dolby 5.1 setup to help you ensure they're all working correctly. So you should be able to hear tone coming from each individual speaker as highlighted on the card. Wow, that's a lot of ground to cover. So speaker in a Dolby 5.1 setup to help you ensure they're all working correctly. So you should be able to hear tone coming from each individual speaker as highlighted on the card. Wow, that's a lot of ground to cover. So well done for sticking with it. And now that we have your 5.1 or Atmos setup in place and everything is in sync, let's take it for a spin, shall we? Let's. Congratulations. You now have everything you need to set up your SkyQ to its maximum potential. Thank you so much for sticking with us through those sections. We know it's a lot of information to take in, so don't forget that you can revisit each one of these tutorials at any time if you want to check your setup again, or even if you buy any new equipment that might also need calibrating. So now that you know what each section of the test card actually means and which ones you should be using, you can calibrate your own setup perfectly. Then you can sit back, you know what, put your feet up, and enjoy all of this.
Are you watching? Let me show you.
Wave.
To who?
I wouldn't have missed this for the world.
Let's celebrate new beginnings.
Hey, let's get it. Here we go now. I say one, yeah, two, yeah, you, yeah, three, yeah, we,
nice to be here with you. This is a great place. I should have been here before. It's marvelous. From all of us, ladies and gentlemen, to all of you, we want to welcome you to the show. I want to thank our promoters who do a magnificent concert. I want to say hello to all our performer friends and the audience.
Check if your remote is paired by pressing the voice button. If you see a message on screen, it's paired. If nothing happens, point your remote at your SkyQ box, press home, then press and hold 1 and 3 until you see the light on your remote flash. Follow the instructions on screen. Press the buttons or touchpad to move through menus and press in the middle to select. If you've got a touch remote and you want to swipe to move around, you can turn touch control on or off to swipe instead of pressing. Press home, go to settings, then setup, and remote control. Choose SkyQ touch remote and press the middle button to turn it on or off. If you can't see the option, you don't have a touch remote. To fast forward or rewind at a faster speed, press the buttons more than once. Press search to find shows. Or if you've got a voice control button on the side or front, press and hold it while speaking clearly into the microphone, then let go. The Sky button takes you straight to your recordings, and the sidebar button opens TV apps. If you can't find your remote, press the Q button on the front of your box, and it'll beep for 30 seconds. For more, go to sky.com/help.
Seven-oh-six, colors. 707.
Be back. Open Spotify. Forrest Gump. Watch Sky Atlantic.
What a chance for Pierre-Emerick.
Be back. Open Spotify. Forrest Gump. Watch Sky Atlantic.